Well, welcome to the very, very first edition of the Bowls Hour, which is brought to you by Summerset Retirement Villages and Dynasty Clothing. This is going to be a new regular podcast, put my teeth back in, talking all things bowls. I'm going to be joined by Alex Reed, who's my co-host. You'll hear from him shortly. And we'll get a variety of bowling personalities on our show. This is our special pre-Christmas show, and we're going to be talking to Kevin Hickland, Mark Cameron, Leif Selby, and Val Smith. What more could you want? And joining me now, my co-host, Alex Reed.
Hello. Yeah, I'm really happy to be here. It's quite exciting, this new podcast, and particularly exciting to be starting off. We've got Kevin Hickland here in our Bowls New Zealand studio with us to have a chat about the Nationals. So I thought I'd pose a few questions to you, Kev. So the first one, I reckon, is, you know, what are your picks for players that might run deep in the Nationals this year?
Well, one thing I can say, Alex, over my many years of following and being involved with Nationals is never try and predict the winner. that's the first thing, because you'll never get it right. It's harder than trying to pick a Melbourne Cup winner, actually, to try and pick a winner. But, you know, it always comes, most of the Nationals, though, your leading players would get their way through section play. Not very often you'll see one of the leading players not make it through. So I'm picking that all of the leading players in the various events will make their way through. Of course, a couple of absentees this year, that being, of course, Joe Edwards and the woman's not been there, and also Shannon McElroy not there as well. Mike Kernan, of course, won't be there as well, the high-performance man for Bowls New Zealand now. His daughter's actually getting married on the 7th of January in Hamilton. So
I suppose that's an okay reason.
I mean, if it was my daughter, I'd be saying, excuse me, what about planning? What about consulting daddy before you start doing things like that?
I can tell you this, that in the family debate, Kate, the daughter, won the debate over what date the wedding was going to be.
If I had a daughter, she'd probably win it as well.
So definitely she won the debate. And of course, Shannon McElroy not being there, but, you know, the good news about Shannon, of course, although not being there, he sort of had a bit of a retirement phase late last year. But the good thing going forward for New Zealand selection in the Commonwealth Games, of course, next year, Shannon's now available for New Zealand selection. So that's a big plus going forward. But, of course, in the men's singles, we've got Mike Galloway, last year's winner. Taylor Horn, of course, a winner of the past. The Raymond Martin, Tony Grantham. You know, all of those leading players. And with the women, of course, we've got the legendary Val Smith, the New Zealand Bowler of the Year, and so rightly so for last year for her performances. Just outstanding year last year. And she would team up again with Lisa Prideaux and the Peers. Now, they, in the last 3 years, they have won the New Zealand Peers twice and have beaten semi-finalist in the third year. So, you know, they've got a very, very good record, and one would expect them to be there, you know, fairly well down in post-section play. But then, of course, we've got the Boyd sisters, Mandy and Angela Boyd, two of the really high-performing players in New Zealand. You know, Mandy, of course, bronze medalist in Glasgow in 2014. We've got Selena Goddard teaming up with Amy McElroy. Amy McElroy, also part of that bronze medal side, the wife of Shannon, of course. So Shannon's looking after the two children. And Amy, of course, is now teaming up with her mate, Selena Goddard. All in all, I think good quality field on good quality greens in Christchurch. And I know the high-performance guys have been saying, look, don't worry too much about the Nationals. That's not a prerequisite for Commonwealth Games selection. Well, all I'll say, they put that thought in the rubbish tin. And believe me, all of these New Zealand high-performance squad members, they will be there trying to win a national title. And, of course, in Christchurch as well, Alex, we've got the paras and we've got the blind bowlers there as well. So it's a full calendar from the 2nd of January through the 9th. The first Nationals I went to was in 1976.
God blimey, it was in black and white then, wasn't it?
So I think I've been to a few and played in a few, watched a few, and, of course, now commentated and covered a number. But, you know, to pick winners...
Yeah, it's always fun to talk about, though, isn't it? To pick.
Yeah, oh, very much so. I would like to ask you that, Kev, actually. In terms of the overall standard of bowls, do you think it's changed much in the years? Was it better then, or do you think that there's more talent coming through in a wider array of it? I'm not talking about individuals necessarily.
Well, there's a couple of things which have happened in that regard, Miles, is the greens have changed significantly. Like in those days, for example, you'd hear the bowls crackling on the surface. That's how quick they were. You know, they're around 20, 21 Now, of course, we're playing on greens that traditionally we look at around between, let's say, 16 to 18 seconds is a normal speed, a weed green, which is mostly what they play on now. The bowls have changed as well considerably to what we played in those days, the Kostiniches and Unkoviches and Phil Skoglund and those guys. So the bowls have changed. And also the advent of the younger guys and girls, and they now, as is very, very evident in the New Zealand High Performance Squad, you know, youth is very, very much to the fore in amongst that squad, and we're going to see more of that.
I suppose the more success these youngsters have, the more interest their peers and younger people have in actually participating in bowls. So it's sort of it's been a snowballing effect.
A great change. Like if you think, you spoke about Phil Skoglund. I think when he won his first national singles title, he was 20 or 21, wasn't
Correct,
he, Kevin?
Correct, he was.
And there was an uproar about that.
There were
clubs that didn't want such young people. If you're fit and healthy, you shouldn't be playing bowls. So I think it's a really cool change in our attitudes, really, and it's
thing, of course, as well, Alex, which has also happened, is we've seen the relaxation of attire on the greens. We've seen coloured shirts, coloured clothing, coloured bowls.
And you talk about the uniform. I remember talking a while ago to Val Smith, Joe Edwards as well, and the pair of them had to wear these really long skirts that you could hardly move in, and they didn't really want to be seen out in public wearing them, so they'd go in a sort of blacked out van to the game and then straight home afterwards.
Well, I can tell you, Marlene Castle will tell you the story. She can remember in her earlier days of playing, about 1989-90, and a particular event, the umpire of the day came on with a tape measure to make sure that her dress, skirt, whatever it was of the
requisite length.
Absolutely.
Not showing too much ankle.
Yeah, that's right.
Oh, that's cool. So we'll move on. I've got another question for you, Kev. I was talking to Mike Galloway at a recent representative fixture about him going to the Christchurch Nationals. And he was telling me it's his first time he's played in a Nationals that's not in Auckland. In your years of going to the Nationals, have you noticed, is there a difference between playing in Nationals in Auckland and the clubs and the people there versus playing in somewhere like Christchurch?
Well, yeah, very. If we firstly look at the greens as an example, Alex, in the main, comparing between Christchurch and Auckland, although it is changing in Auckland. But you know, the South Island, of course, is the home of Cochlear, the home of Dunedin and Christchurch, the home of the weed green, so to speak, and they're completely running different surface to what we've traditionally had up here in Auckland, where you have the star weed green, which runs as a completely different. Different pace, different style. And also a very important point is that your shot selection that you can play in Auckland, as an example, I know it sounds a bit far-fetched, but your shot selection on Auckland greens compared to, say, Canterbury greens, although we play with different bowls now, you know, narrow running bowls, but your shot selection is different on those greens compared to the Auckland greens. Another thing, of course, in Christchurch, just about every day at around about 11 o'clock, the Nor'wester decides to arrive just about on the clock, and that can certainly make a difference. But the good thing, I think, now, though, Alex, is that with the change of bowls and full marks to the New Zealand Greenkeepers Association, we've got what I'll call now far more uniform greens that the players can play on. The other thing about the differences as well is changed, which has made a difference, because in the past, of course, we used to play singles, pairs and fours. So it was an event that drew itself right out to about the 14th, 15th of January. Well, the life of people now has changed so dramatically that time is now really not available. So condensing it. So that's also made a difference as well to people on the time commitments that you've got to make.
Yeah, I'm intrigued to just follow the Aucklanders in particular, given that we've had an interesting 107 days or whatever it is. I'll be intrigued to see what the Aucklanders or the top half of the North Island results are in this upcoming Christchurch and Nationals.
Correct, but I think we've got some players, and you mentioned like Michael Galloway as an example, and Lisa Bredeau is another one. The great thing of those two players that I mentioned is it's about their delivery. I don't think for those top-level players, I don't think it'll make too big a difference.
So your cream rising to the top, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Okay, well, we've got one more question to ask, and we intend, we've got three more people after you, Kev, and we're going to ask them the same question. It's to make this a Christmas show. What's your favourite Christmas song, if you had to pick one?
Please don't say Snoopy.
Oh, well, no, yeah, we will be judging. We will be judging these, I think.
No. I want it have to be White Christmas.
Well, good old tradition. Yeah, not wrong with a bit of Bing Crosby.
You can't beat Bing, can you?
Well, I think it might still be the greatest selling single of all time.
Well, it was certainly up there, wasn't it?
Yeah, it is the greatest selling single of all time.
Everybody knows it. And so, yeah, that's it's mine. But look, Alex and Miles, I'd just like to wish all the bowlers out there, you know, very, very Merry Christmas, safe Christmas, travel safe, and have a wonderful Christmas and all the best of 2022.
Well, thank you very much indeed, Kevin Hickland there. He's the font of all knowledge, New Zealand bowls. He's been around a long time, 1976, as he mentioned. We'll be back shortly here on the Bowls Hour with the CEO of Bowls New Zealand, Mark Cameron.
I'm dreaming of a white Christmas, just like the one.
Welcome back to the Bowls Hour, brought to you by Summerset Retirement Villages and Dynasty Apparel. Well, I'm looking forward to this one because I'm sure there's a lot of questions that need to be asked and answered, and a lot of good stories coming out of what has been quite a fraught year. CEO of Bowls New Zealand, Mark Cameron, I'll hand it over to you. Alex, so you can start grilling him.
Cool, yeah, we won't call it a grilling, but I've got a couple of questions to ask, and we thought we'd start with a serious one. Mark, I just wanted to get a feeling for how
you... Just remember that you're in the employee here, right?
Yeah,
So grilling the boss is something I'd be hesitant about.
Do you want me to do it?
Carry on, Alex.
Pass the question to me, Alex, and I'll grill it.
If I go really quiet, something's happened. I was going to ask you, how's your bowls career sort of tracking at the moment?
Oh, Mark? Look, I'm pleased you asked. No one ever really asked me about this, but this year I'm proudly a double club title winner.
Yes.
Do I get a badge for that?
I suppose there will be a badge.
Or is it at five? Do you get like fives and tens?
How many people are in the club? Five?
No.
It's not relevant.
So which titles did you win? That's quite impressive.
Thank you very much.
So which ones did you win?
The Mighty Ponsonby Bowling Club, which has been around since 1893.
So you've defected from Riverhead?
No,
dual membership.
Yeah. I put my bets both ways on these things. So at Ponsonby Bowling Club, 1893, a very, very rich history. Some superb bowlers that have come out of Ponsonby. And the Peers title this year. With Alex Reid, actually.
Yeah, I mean, there may be an ultimate reason why I asked that question.
You kept that one quiet, didn't you? Yeah, carry on.
And then a fours title as well.
With Alex Reid?
Oh, perhaps.
So how heavy was he to carry, Alex?
Oh, it was good. It was good. Mark played well. He played exceptionally well.
I skipped the peers for a number of peers game until we got to the semi-final and final.
And then
I bailed.
That's what's called being sensible.
That's the boss.
Yeah, so your career's going pretty well,
thanks,
Mark.
Thanks, Alex. Yeah. It is a little bit, but I think like everyone, certainly in the Auckland region, we've really struggled over the last 4 months now. No ability to get on the greens. And it's only in the last couple of weeks that we've seen, I think, Auckland clubs actually lift again. Mm-hmm. But they've had a tough old time, as of all bowlers, I think, over the last 12 months.
That segues lovely to the next question, Mark, I was going to ask you is, how have you found sort of trying to manage the ship in this season of COVID that we've had?
Well, I think not so much us. I think the team here at Bowls New Zealand is, we carry on doing our jobs. But I think the bowls community, it's been pretty tough. I guess what it's shown is resilience of people. And that's pretty cool. And that's really cool to see because we've long promoted bowls as being more than just physical sport. It's actually for your mental health as well. So at times like this, you know, and with COVID, I think that coming together as a community for the mental health benefits has been really, really cool.
What about the financial benefits for the club? I mean, the Auckland clubs in particular, which have been locked down, that must have hit them. I know bar takings aren't massive there, but all those little bits and pieces they do, it must have impacted on them.
Most bowling clubs, a lot of their revenue comes through this pre-Christmas period. In Auckland, it's dropped to zero, and that's really, really hurt. And we've been well supported by the government, though, through the sport resilience funds that have been available. And, you know, we're pleased to say that no club's falling over, but tough times. And I guess that's the beauty about community and volunteers, though, is that when the times do get tough, people step up. And that's what's been happening with our clubs.
Yeah, it's cool. It was good to see after our last lockdown. We saw a lot of clubs get really good support for their club events, and a lot of people sort of thronging back to the club. So I expect we'll see that again this time around, and it should be a good time for all, I hope.
Just to pick up on that point, I'm quite optimistic we'll see a bounce back next year.
Yeah, and you get itchy fingers having, I didn't play a bowl for 107 days, or however long it was that we were locked in our houses. And it was, you know, to get back out on the green, it's good. They don't go where they meant to, but it's a good time. It's fun.
You could always take up that indoor bowl sport.
I did try to get my mat into my garage, but it turns out that my garage is full. So that was the end of that.
That's
so,
not a surprise, Alex, because I've seen your workstation in the office here, and you know, yeah.
Well, we'll see.
You're a hoarder.
We'll see if this stays in the podcast. So another thing that's sort of been popping up, it was before COVID, we saw it in the news. We've got the Olympics being hosted in Australia in
2032. Yep. Brisbane is the Olympics, and the Paralympics as well.
Mm-hmm.
So that's quite important for us as a sport, because we're in a space now internationally where we're trying to figure out what our international game looks like. All these other sports now are going short format to try and appease the commercial market, the TV broadcasters. We're already seeing the 5N type game as being quite a opportunity in terms of the televising of our sport. It used to be that actually, you know, going watching a sport for an hour was short, you know, but now it's like 20 minutes or 25 minutes, and sometimes shorter than that in terms of sport watching. So the 32 Olympics is part of a broader discussion around what does our sport look like internationally going forward in that new commercial market. That's the challenge for 32. And the other challenge for 32 is how do we, as a sport, how does bowls break into new markets? Because really we're not that evidenced in Europe, outside of, you know, Great Britain, in Asia, outside of the likes of Malaysia, and now China a little bit, and the Americas bowls isn't big. So you really need our product to be big in one of those three markets, and it's a real challenge for us if we want to get to 32 Olympics.
People might not realise this, but the World Championships, which used to be held once every 4 years, I believe that's been tottered with a little bit, and it's now once every...
2 years.
2 years?
Yeah. So we've obviously looked to get more product on the international calendar. The other challenge for us is Com Games. So recently the Com Games Federation put out that they're only protecting two sports from here on in.
Yes.
I want to say athletics and swimming. So suddenly bowls is under challenge.
That's an interesting thing there. I'd be careful if I was the Commonwealth Games, because you can ill afford to alienate any people who support you, like any of the sports that are in there, because the Commonwealth Games themselves are under threat. Their legitimacy, their sort of their value as such on a wider scale. I mean, obviously, if you're an athlete participating in it, it's great, and you want to achieve it, and it's another opportunity to do something. But in terms of viewing figures, and in terms of people suddenly starting to dismiss it, people not bothering to turn up for certain events and picking and choosing, they've got to be careful as well.
Yeah, I think so, but they've also got to be realistic, and I think that's the message we've taken. It's not so much that bowls will go from the calendar, or from the program, I should say. It's that at the moment we're in 11 disciplines, so there's 11 medals up for grabs in bowls.
Yeah.
And I think the realistic part of that is actually to go, well, actually that's quite a cost for the host to actually deliver, you know, to 11 disciplines, and maybe that should be more likely
trim
four or five. And probably the right way of describing this is there's real opportunity for us to relook at the international game and reflect perhaps what's happening locally as well, or domestically. We've seen over the last 2 or 3 years the rise of bowls 3-5,
yeah.
You know, those short 1 hour type packaged games. I think it's happening domestically. It'll need to go onto the international scene.
So essentially it comes down to a viewpoint, doesn't it? Like, you can look at something through not a great lens, or you can look at it as an opportunity to change.
I'm a big fan for two yearly world championships. I mean, why wouldn't you have it every year, I suppose, other than cost? I mean, it's not as if...
To be fair, we've had a world champion for a while now, and that's been great.
Well, Shannon McElroy, yeah, the record. You know, he'd probably be, the way Omicron's coming along, he'll probably be champion in 2047.
It's a great thing to be able to say. It's good. Okay, I've got another question for you, Mark. So we're heading into the 2022 season. What's the thing you're most excited about for Bowls New Zealand heading into next year?
For us, I guess within the organisation itself, it's the work we're currently now doing in terms of this media broadcast space. So, you know, here we are producing a podcast, and this podcast will end up being on SENZ radio on a Wednesday night going forward. So that's pretty cool. We will carry on and we'll do far more live streaming than we've ever done in the past. And next year, we're also looking to do a post-produced event coverage as well, which will be a really sharp product that we can put out on wider platforms. You know, if there's one thing that that certainly I saw when I came in, we need to continue challenging that perception of bowls being granddad and his whites. I saw that damn KFC ad on again.
Oh, it just keeps coming back
on TV.
Sue them.
We asked them wings. For a game of bowls, but yeah. they never responded.
Awesome wicked wings. We'll take those instead of the game of bowls, won't we, Alex? So just changing that perception from granddad and his whites to what it really is. Mm. You know, you can't go to a bowling club in the country and they're all wearing whites anymore. You know, it's coloured bowls, it's coloured clothing. It's such a diverse group of people, young and old, you know, men and women and so on. And I think that's where that, you know, you talk about the challenge for next year or the move next year. It's to continue to push that promotion of our product to a wider platform.
Yeah, like basically putting the counter argument for putting the case forward. Yeah, no, I agree there. That is an issue. And I think you've made a good inroads into that already.
The average age of our blackjacks, now that Mike Kernahan's retired,
yes,
is probably under 30 now.
It's lower. Oh, it
sorry, Mike.
Yeah, no.
It used to be lower than the average age of the New Zealand cricket team.
Yeah.
Which I thought was a cool statistic.
Yeah. And that's pretty darn cool. Yeah. That's the one as an organisation and staff and community we can be proud of, is when we see our bowls product that we love so much up there on TV and people are commentating it on. And Miles, you know, you would have seen the effect of 3-5 over the last 3 years.
Oh, massively. I mean, seriously, on radio, I get rung up so many times, people talking about that, asking when it's coming back on, and they really engage with it.
Okay, I got one last quick question. We're going to ask all our guests this. We've had an answer from Kevin earlier, which was acceptable.
Please don't make it unacceptable, your answer to this question.
Well, depends what the question is.
It's a very important question. I'll be frightened. What's your favourite Christmas song, Mark?
Oh, it's Christmas edition. I did hear that conversation around the office yesterday, actually. I thought to myself, I know what it is, and I thought I should be embarrassed by it, but I'll roll with it anyway. So Boney M and Mary's Boy Child. I don't know. I like every now and again a little bit of Boney M with that stereotype music that comes firing at you is quite good. Is it on the Bowls New Zealand Spotify playlist?
It is on our Bowls New Zealand Christmas Spotify playlist that we
brilliant.
Had.
Yeah.
There right, you go. Well, thank you very much indeed for that. Mark Cameron, CEO of Bowls in New Zealand. Right, stay with us here on the Bowls Hour, brought to you by Summerset Retirement Villages and Dynasty Apparel. And next up, we're going to have Leif Selby, who's a multiple world championship winner and the new head of coaching for Auckland Bowls. What a signing for Auckland Bowls. Man will live forevermore because of Christmas Day. Welcome back to the Bowls Hour, brought to you by Summerset Retirement Villages and Dynasty Apparel. Alex Reid, my co-host, and I are joined now. I'm really looking forward to this. His name is Leif Selby, apparently named after a magnificent Viking explorer. And according to Alex, he's a bowls god. Welcome, Leif.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, bowls god, I'm not sure about that, but I'll take it. Thank you.
I don't think I ever spoke, but we'll find out. Yeah, so thanks for joining us, Leif. We're just going to throw a few questions at you and see what your responses are. It's good to have you in our Bowls New Zealand studio. So the first question I was going to flick your way is, obviously, you're from Australia and have played a lot of bowls over there and have recently moved to New Zealand. How are you finding it over here? That's what Kiwis like to ask. Hey, how are you finding it?
Oh, we're loving it. We currently live on Waiheke Island. We moved there because we like it. Beautiful place, and look, we're moving over to the mainland in the middle of next month, so a bit of a shame to leave the island, but you know, we have to do what's right for us.
Yeah, so the move, is it you know, work commitments for that makes it easy for you being over this side?
Yes, it is. My partner Lisa is a bowler as well. Unfortunately, on the island, there is one bowling club at the green. It's a synthetic green, and it's just not quite suitable to do some proper training on. So now that I work for Auckland Bowls, the travelling is getting a little bit too much, so we have to make the move across.
So you had success last year in our National Champion of Champion Pairs playing with James Williams. Was it good to get back into like competitive bowls? Because you had a while off, didn't you?
Yes, I haven't played much in the last, close to 10 years.
You are a bleeding god, if you can give up for that. So can I just ask you, though, this is just a personal thing, why were you out of the game for so long? I mean, you're a world champion multiple times. Why did you give it up?
Okay, my daughter was quite young at the time, competitive swimmer, so the time commitment that she had to put into it was unbelievable, you know, and I was never at home when I was competing as well, so I felt like I was missing out, and in the end I felt a bit too selfish being away so much doing my thing. Once I'd finished everything I'd set out to do, I kind of felt a little bit lost, like, where do I go from here? And then sort of started to find some other things to do and basically just, yeah, wanted to get out there and live the life that everyone else was. And I really enjoyed it. I got away from the club industry and started to do some different jobs. Then Auckland Bowls, I was approached by Auckland Bowls to get back into it. So, and when I played with James and the pairs, I really enjoyed it. Myself and the time we had on the green playing together. So I'm really looking forward to getting back in and playing a little bit of competitive bowls. Not too much, mind you, just enough to keep the enjoyment there. Yeah.
Fair enough. That's a really good answer. That's great.
Yeah, I think in terms of, you know, as a parent, I've got six boys. I know exactly what you mean, that you want to be able to spend that time with you. And hey, you say you were fortunate to achieve it. I think it's more down to hard work and ability that you achieve what you did. But at least you've done it and you're back now. And I think Auckland Bowls will be very excited about it. What role are you actually doing there?
Okay, my role there is coach and player development. So it was pretty much the same role as what I was doing back home, and I've done that for 20 years or more. So with Auckland Bowls, basically what I'm doing at the moment is canvassing all of the clubs in the Auckland region with expressions of interest to try and recruit some new foundation level coaches at each club. So some clubs already have coaches, but I believe it's important that we continue to replenish the troops, so to speak. So once I get round and to all the clubs there and start to recruit some new coaches, then I can work along with them. Big contrast that I noticed from the Australian clubs, the New Zealand clubs. The majority of the club members are more social side players and not so much competitive. So when we get some new coaches at every club is the ultimate goal. I can come along and assist then and we can introduce some programs to try and get the members to transition into playing more their club championships and more competitive, to try and help boost the clubs up from the inside that way.
Yeah, that sounds really good. So you've had a pretty good response from the clubs you've been to so far?
Yeah, it's been terrific. I've actually had a couple of group sessions at clubs. I had one on Monday morning, for instance, out at Howick, and there were 60 people. And the weather wasn't that great, so we were basically just inside, so they were just listening to me speak.
There's going to be a positive spin-off for bowls generally in New Zealand by doing a program like that, in terms of trying to get people to take the game more seriously or be more competitive. You're going to unearth more gems, as well as coaching people who enjoy their game more socially because they can play a little bit better. You could unearth some gems to play for the national side.
Certainly. So the ultimate goal for Bowls Auckland is to strengthen the Auckland region. But what I'm most excited about is the opportunity to introduce the exact same training regiment that I put myself through to all the members.
And that went okay, didn't it, that training regimen?
It really worked for me. It helped me exceed all my expectations and took me to great heights. So, yes, I had a burning, passionate desire to be the best that I could whilst I was doing it. But I'm really delighted to be able to introduce the exact same training regimen to all the Auckland bowlers in the region.
That's awesome. And you, I saw you down there. I was at Hunter's Corner. There was a Battle of the Bridge, it's called. I think you and I might have commentated on one of those.
We did commentate on that a couple of years ago, yeah.
The Battle of the Bridge, where it's Bowls North Harbour versus Auckland Bowls. As part of your role as the Auckland coach or the head of coaches or whatever you want to call it, does that involve sort of coaching the rep teams at that high level as well as going to all the clubs and members?
Exactly. So I got around to all three venues just to have a look and see how each player and team was performing. I'll be working closely with all the representative players. Also, some players that the selectors have identified as up-and-coming talent. So when I say I'll be working closely with them, I'll be issuing them an individual training program that I can monitor. And the more these exercises that they do, the more I learn, and then I can alter their program to suit their needs. It's a complete skill set program. Also, they'll be learning how to channel their focus and concentration on key aspects of the game. They'll also learn to identify their emotions when their emotions start to kick in and start to tamper with their mindset. We could do other activities as well, such as talk some tactics, some head reading activities, and I may even let some of my trade secrets out that I picked up during my career. Maybe.
How to unsettle the opposition.
Not on this podcast, though, eh? It's a bit too big an audience. Okay, so I suppose the question I have, coming from Australia to New Zealand, and our greens and stuff are different. Have you noticed, how's the game different here? Because it must be played, is it played in a different way? Like, have you noticed there's a difference in aggression or head reading or something in the Kiwis?
Yeah, good question. The game has evolved a lot over the last 15 years. It's become a lot more aggressive and a lot more tactical. But typically the greens in New Zealand run a lot faster. However, in Australia during the winter months, because they're grass, the grass sort of turns dormant, and the greens over there can run in excess of 16, 17 seconds as well. But once the pace matches the New Zealand pace over here, in Australia the bowls turn a hell of a lot more. So there is a bit of a contrast, but you just make the adjustment. And look, I played in New Zealand, both North and South Island, quite a bit when I was playing back in the day as well. So, yeah.
No, it's interesting. It's interesting. We had Kevin Hickland in here earlier and we spoke to him. Actually, this is a good question. We asked him how he thought bowls had changed. So his first national was 1976, did he say, Miles?
Yeah, 76.
76, and he was talking about watching bowls back then. I know your memory probably doesn't go back quite that far, Leif. But do you think if we look at the bowlers from, say, the 80s and the 90s and the standard of the game then, is it fair to compare what we've got now? And if it is fair, do you think we're better or worse or the same?
Oh, geez, back in those days, they're playing on the same surface, but the bowls that they had were quite heavy, biased bowls. So the skill level that they were playing at then was phenomenal. Obviously, the bowls manufacturers have altered the bowls to minimum bias and all these stuff. There's a range of different biases now, which can be a little bit confusing at times. But there's still a great level of skill that's involved in the game. But, geez, it has changed a lot. But a lot more aggressive and attacking type gameplay.
Yeah. Do you think we probably get tighter heads now, don't we? Because it's easier, if you think it's easier to get a bowl in a place nowadays, do you think our heads are a bit more packed up than what it might have been 30 years ago?
They definitely are, yes. And that's what I think leads to the more aggressive gameplay as well, yeah.
Are you more of a shot maker, or are you quite like a bit of aggression and blasting the head to pieces?
No, it depends on the day. I'm more of a singles player. I was known more of a singles player, so... a bit of both. It's you got to have all the artillery in your bag. But singles is a very lonely game out there, so you're sort of dealing with your own headspace, and you just tend to stick to what your strengths are.
You've got no one else to drag you out of the poo.
There's nobody to talk to.
It's a good way to put it, Miles.
Quite good when you're winning. The crowd will engage with you, but when you're losing, it's a very lonely game out there, the old singles, yeah.
That's a fair call. Okay, we've got one more question for you, Leif, and we've asked it to our first two guests, and we've judged them on it as well. It's a really important question.
Yeah, we're judging.
Yeah, it's to add a Christmas flavour to this pre-Christmas podcast. If you had to pick one favourite Christmas song, what would it be?
I guess it would have to be "Do They Know It's Christmas Time?" Feed the World.
That's a great song.
Yeah, it's a mid-80s song, and it was a collation of a lot of the popular singers at that time. I guess that's one that just comes to mind, and it's a very catchy tune, and with a good message. So.
Yeah,
that's a good
fundraiser
answer
as well. Yeah, much better than the American one that they did. I can't remember the name of the American one.
Oh, they've tried to redo it a couple of times, haven't they? It's not quite
But that one there, the original Band-Aid Bob Geldof.
That's the one.
Inspired one. That's magnificent. Thank you very much indeed for your time, Leif Selby there. Now, coach of coaches at Auckland Bowls. I think it's a great acquisition, and we look forward to chatting to you again throughout the year. And good luck, and have a great Christmas.
Thanks so much, and have a good Christmas to you too. Thank you.
Right, we will be back with, I'll tell you what, we've got one world champion here. We're going to get another one floating up soon, and she won many titles. Val Smith will be joining us next on the Bowls Hour. Welcome back to the Bowls Hour, brought to you by Summerset Retirement Villages and Dynasty Apparel. Well, we've had three magnificent guests, and I think we've saved the best for last. World champion Val Smith joins us now, and apparently, according to Alex, you're bursting at the brim and ready to talk to us.
Yeah, I was predicting what I thought Val would be feeling at this moment, Miles. I'm not sure if I got it right or not, but yes, we have Val Smith on the line. How are you, Val?
I'm good, thank you.
That's great news. Okay, so we've got a few questions to ask, and I thought I'd start at the beginning. So most bowlers will know by now, you spent a little while in Australia, you moved back to New Zealand relatively recently, I suppose, in this weird, timeless COVID time that we have. How you find it being back home?
I'm loving it. I'm absolutely loving being back home, being back in my own place, and being in Nelson with my... Because the friends I've got here in Nelson, I've known for a long, long period of my life. So, being friends 30, 40 years. So, and my sister. So I just feel very comfortable and relaxed back here in Nelson.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah. And you've had some success at your bowling club back. Has that been sort of cool to come back and have that success? And what would you put that down to?
Oh, yeah, because it was interesting because coming back, particularly with it was during the COVID time, and I didn't really have any expectations for the season. But what I found is that as soon as I got back into the Nelson Bowling Club, like all the people there were familiar to me and known them for a long time, and just the friendships just sparked naturally. And I think that went a long way to my success of last season.
Do you think that also, Val, and I'll do this on behalf because you're a very humble human being, that it might also be the fact that you're brilliant at bowls that might have helped you settle back in?
I think the success, because it was funny because, I mean, I'll be honest, my training regime last season was very limited compared to what I've done in the past. I think I just sort of... trained when I felt I needed to, like if I felt like I had a bit of a flaw in my technique or a weakness in my game, I'd go out and practice it. But I didn't put in the hours of training like I had done in previous years. But I think it was more the fact that I was in a much better mental space last year by being back home. Sometimes you just carry a bit of weight with you. I just felt like that had all been shifted. My mind just felt a lot freer.
So, yeah, to answer the question, you're pretty happy to be back in New Zealand. We're really happy to have you back here as well, Val. We were just having a chat on a slightly different note. Leif Selby was the person we had on before, and he's obviously moved from Australia to New Zealand as well. And we were asking him about the differences between the Australian game and the New Zealand game, and you spent a few years in Aussie playing at a really high level there. When you came back to New Zealand, do you think we play the game differently over here? And if we do, how is it different?
Well, I don't feel that we play it a lot differently over here than over in Australia. I felt like I took my style of game to Australia. We back ourselves on the draw, I think. We play the draw games are probably a bigger part of our game here. But I think that's because of the greens, the surfaces that we play on. We can't really afford to play that sort of tight arriving weight, because if you miss, the bowl doesn't tend to hang around, where the surfaces over in Australia allow you to play that style of game. We can sort of poaching weight, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, that makes
sense. But we've got to play sort of more drawing to the jack rather than through the jack over here, because if, like I say, if you miss, you don't end up with a very effective bowl. So we're either draw or drive, basically, over here in Australia. They can play a variety of weights and still end up with a handy bowl.
Yeah, your effective bowls, eh? Yeah, that's a good answer. It's interesting just to think about. I find it interesting because I'm a bowl's tragic, but it's interesting to think about the differences and the way that we sort of play the game in different areas of the country and world, I suppose. Okay, so we'll flick on to the next question. All going well, as long as COVID keeps on sort of staying mostly out of the way. We've got a Commonwealth Games that's coming up really, really soon, and we've got a you're part of that wider New Zealand squad that's training for that. Have you started ramping up for the practice for that yet, Val?
I'm not doing anything in regards to the Birmingham preparation at this stage. I put in a bit of time during the second half of the winter. I went to two training camps on croquet lawns. I was doing the training, but then when the next round of COVID came in and everything started to be cancelled and postponed and pushed back, then we were starting to encroach on our own season. And I decided to put the croquet lawn training to the side and concentrate back on the fast greens and wait and see what's going to pan out.
Val, can I just say, it's interesting you mentioned that the croquet lawns, and I've heard that a lot, that the croquet lawns are more similar to the bowls that you'll find, the bowling greens you'll find in the UK. How hard is it to find a croquet lawn? Like, if I wouldn't know where one, I live in Auckland, I wouldn't know where one was. Is there quite a few of them floating around?
I would say so. You just Google it, I suppose. Just get on But, and then just ring the secretary. They're pretty good. The croquet clubs, there's two in Nelson. There's the Nelson Croquet Club and there's one out at Richmond as well. And I've approached both clubs to train on their lawns. They love it. They love seeing you there down there.
Have you tried croquet, Val? I've never tried. Don't understand croquet. Does anyone know how it works?
I haven't tried it. I've had a little crack, but not properly. But I used to work at the croquet lawns in Nelson. When I finished my horticulture and gardening apprenticeship, I spent 4 years working at the lawn tennis courts and croquet lawns.
Oh, how good.
In Nelson. Yeah. So they used to host national tournaments, and the members would explain when the good players were playing, they would explain what they're trying to do. It's a brutal game.
Yeah,
you can smack the opposition's ball about
as far as you want,
mile away, and they've got to go all the way back to the start. And
I don't think I'd be very happy if someone did that to me at bowls if they hoofed it over the fence or something.
Did you critique the lawns, Val, when you were there? Did you critique, when you go to it, say, oh, when in my day it was a lot better?
Well, the last time I rolled up with them, it wasn't much to compare because I think the poor old groundsman had something wrong with his machinery and he'd put gouges all through the lawns, so they'll definitely be all doing that.
Oh dear. That's not ideal. So
it was interesting to train on too.
Obviously we've got a Commonwealth Games in the Northern Hemisphere again this year and we've had some World Bowls up there in the past. How many times, if you make the Commonwealth Games squad, do you feel you've had that experience enough to know what you're looking forward to playing in?
I've got the experience, I know what to expect, so that's one good thing. I actually enjoy playing in the Northern Hemisphere. It's hard, because we have to, change our technique so much, and you can't get away with a poor technique. You'll get shown up in the Northern Hemisphere. But it's an exciting game on the slower greens, because very rarely does the jack stay in the same place for the entire length of the end. So you're always looking to get down to the jack, so you're always pushing through bowls, so the jack gets nudged around quite a bit. So it's an exciting game.
Is there a position that you would like to be selected in for the Commonwealth Games, or if you're not that far ahead?
I think a lot of it comes down to the overall team dynamic. I think any position's a good position if you're in a team that's, like a well-selected side. Ideally, I'd like to play, say, top end, either skip or three in the four. When I start naming them, I end up pretty much naming every single position. But I'm quite happy to play anywhere, actually. I don't mind.
Yeah, that's fair enough. That's a good answer too, yeah. Val. Okay, so we'll sort of vaguely wrap it up now. We have a Christmas theme, a very weak Christmas theme to this podcast. We've had three guests so far and we've asked them all the same question and we've judged them on it as well, so we're going to fling it towards you. If you had to pick one Christmas song as your favourite Christmas song of all time, what would it be?
Wow, that's a hard one.
It is.
I like Merry Christmas, Everybody by Slade.
That is a very good choice. Actually, of all the choices we've had so far, That is by far the best, Val. So you go to the top of our Christmas song picking list.
Yeah. They don't play it enough on the radio, though, here.
I'll tell you what, Val, I'll be on the radio a lot over Christmas, so I'll play it and I'll dedicate it to you when I play it, okay?
Oh, thank you.
Well, thank you so much for your time, Val. We really appreciate it. We as Alex has said, we love having you back in New Zealand. All the best for a great Christmas and New Year and for the Commonwealth Games in Birmingham.
Hey, thanks very much, guys. And you have a great Christmas as well and Happy New Year.
Thank you. That was Val Smith, the world champion. And we've had, two world champions on it? Yeah, two world champions on the show. Our very first episode of The Bowls Hour. We shall be back in the new year bringing you a lot more. But before we go, your Christmas song, Alex.
Yes. I've put some thought into it. And I thought Kevin was going to steal my thunder when he said White Christmas. Because there's a sort of jazzed up version from the 50s or 60s of the White Christmas.
Yeah.
That's my favourite one. I can't believe who sang it.
Well, you've got to find out who sang it. There's no point in going, that one by someone who might be
one.
This.
Yeah, those people.
That one, okay.
It was sort of like the Mills Brothers-ish sort of later on.
Yeah, no, fair enough. I mean, it is a great song as well. Slade would definitely be right up there I like a wizard version of as well. But my favourite, and the one that I like playing because it's a bit rebellious, is Run Run Rudolph by Lemmy from Motorhead. It's got a little bit of oomph and a grunge in it.
I would imagine, given it's by him, that it would have a little bit of oomph in it.
It is. It's very raw.
I'll make sure to add it to our Christmas
playlist.
Add
it to the playlist, then, yeah. Add it to the playlist. There'll be loads. Well, one person who'll really like it. Well, thank you very much indeed for listening to us. We shall be back, as I say, in the new year. Bowls Hour, brought to you by Summerset Retirement Villages and Dynasty Apparel.